Development E-Talks series co-hosted by CNS and Indian Institute of Management Indore. It is indeed an honor to have with us Professor Nuzhat Hussain as our keynote speaker for today's talk. Dr. Hussain is professor and head of the Department of Pathology and also dean at Dr. Ram Manohar Lohia Institute of Medical Sciences, Lucknow. She is also officer in charge of the State Referral Center for Lab Investigations.
Good afternoon, ma'am. We, the students of Indian Institute of Management, Indore, extend a heartfelt welcome to you. Cervical cancer is one of the preventable and treatable forms of cancer if detected early. It is important to have comprehensive knowledge to prevent and screen for cancer. We are looking forward to hearing your insights today on screening for cervical cancer.
Before handing over the mic to Nuzhat ji, I would like to mention to our audience that she has been at the forefront of announcing and managing some of the community kitchens for providing food to the needy in Lucknow during the lockdown period. And the effort continues. A doctor with a healing touch indeed, in the true sense of the word. Over to you, Dr. Hussain.
Well, thank you so much for a warm welcome and a kind introduction. This topic which I'm going to talk on today is pretty dear to my heart, and we have been hosting camps per se for screening patients of cervical cancer. But what is required is much more than that, and I would like to discuss in detail with you today as to what the approach to the cervical screening of cervical cancer is as of current now, and what are the possibilities and what is the direction we really need to take. So to make out my case today, I would like, this is the roadmap that I'll be taking. Sorry. So, okay, there's a problem here. Apologize for that.
That's okay, take your time.
So that's a roadmap that we'll be taking, and I will introduce you first to the general concepts of this disease. We will look at the magnitude of the problem, emphasizing the need, why we need to deal with it. And then I will tell you what the current screening strategies are available for this. We will look at a newer paradigm we would actually require to do an efficient program for cervical cancer prevention. Some treatment options, just a couple of slides there. We will try to remain a little less scientific and more in terms of a social approach to cervical cancer. So there are controversies, there are positive aspects. Let us get into them as of now. So the magnitude of carcinoma of the uterine cervix, so this is basically the end of the uterus which opens into the vagina. And this is the mouth of the uterus, and this is the area where these cancers, they arise. And unfortunately, these are the they used to be until 5 years back in India the most common cancer in the females. But as of now, it is at number 2 after breast cancer. And it is by far the commonest cancer in rural women. And if we actually look at socioeconomic levels, then in the lower socioeconomic status, this is the most common cancer that is there in women. So definitely it needs to be dealt with. 83% of worldwide cases, they are occurring in developing countries. And this affects the women in their prime or their giving years. So it starts at like 35 years, 30 years of age, and goes on till 55. That's one peak, and then it continues into old age till up to 65 years of age. So because of the age incidence at which these cancers occur, they affect lives, they affect entire families, and hence again dealing with them is really important. The prevention, the important thing, the significant part about this cancer is that it is an extremely preventable form of cancer, and we have all the weaponry in place. But unfortunately, this weaponry has somehow not been utilized to target this disease as yet. The 5-year survival rates are really dismal, and therefore prevention is the only way of stopping the suffering. The etiology of the disease is multifactorial, but the human papilloma virus infection is associated in almost 87 to 96% of cases. So one of the methodologies that we use for screening this is to detect the presence of HPV in the cervix collections. And if the virus is present, the likelihood of that person having the cancer is higher. And then subsequently, you have to test further. So looking at the worldwide distribution, these very dark areas are the very high areas of incidence. Also to be mentioned here is that cancer of the uterine cervix tends to occur in patients who are immunocompromised. And if you see these very dark areas here, these are also regions where HIV is very prevalent. So a lot of uterine cancer cases, these cervix cancer cases in these regions have been found to be associated with HIV, but not so much in our country. We do get an association, but most of them are de novo per se. The color looks kind of lighter here, but if you look on the lower map, this is the mortality. This is the incidence and this is the mortality. And you will realize here that it gets darker, meaning thereby that although we are looking at an incidence which is somewhere between 12 to 20 per 100,000 population, we are looking at a mortality which is much higher, meaning thereby that the health system is also not dealing with this as effectively as it should. So once it occurs, it is diagnosed. Even subsequently, our mortality is fairly high. So if we compare and look at the incidence and the mortality rates, the bars in blue is the mortality and the bars in purple is the incidence. You will see that Nepal has a very high incidence. This is the Asian graph. And you will see India here. So fairly high. This is like 10 and then that's 20. So we are lying somewhere at 15 per 100,000 population. And you will also see here that the mortality is proportionally quite high. You will see these regions here in the Middle East, which have the lowest incidence, which is present here. And then these are the highest is here in Nepal, Indonesia, and Myanmar and so forth. So basically South Asia is like a huge focus for the presence of this cancer. When we look at the Indian scene, JNK data has not been reported in this map. And then we see kind of darker colors here in this Aizwal and the Mizoram region. And then we have these foci also, where Chennai, which actually then started, and Andhra are pretty much affected. Probably these lighter regions, I feel, is lack of data rather than lack of the disease. So the ICMR now has started like a hospital-based registry for cancers, and there are multiple centers which are focused in various regions. We have one in Lucknow, which is placed at SDPGI. And hospital-based data is collected. And since we know the inside and out, we know that there is an insufficiency of the data collection as well. And definitely a population-based cancer registry does not exist. So whatever numbers we are looking at are actually underreported numbers. So all this emphasis basically to emphasize that this is a huge disease and this definitely needs to be dealt with at a national level. These days you have this huge coronavirus scare and then these are the numbers that you're looking at. I know there's a zero less here, but if you look at the deaths, you've had like this many deaths till yesterday. And this is the total number of deaths per year that are occurring because of cervical cancer in the world. So this huge scare, this huge diversion of the entire economic funds and the whole healthcare concentrating on this one disease, I'm not undermining the care that has gone to the disease, but I'm just trying to emphasize that an equal or more number of deaths have already occurred from cervical cancer around the year, and where and how much are we looking at it is the question. And we do not even know how many of them they have recovered and how many will subsequently in the next year be part of this statistic that is present over here. So looking at the predisposing, so that's the magnitude of the problem. Let us look at what are the predisposing factors of this disease. So the predisposing factors that you have, as I said earlier, is the human papilloma virus, This is basically a sexually transmitted virus. And this, in its persistence within the environs of the female genital tract, results subsequently in a malignant change in the lining of the uterine cervix. And this lining of the uterine cervix gives rise to the formation of what we call as a cancer cervix. The coexistence of other STDs like chlamydia and herpes are known to accelerate or enhance the susceptibility of the person to the malignancy, but per se, HPV is the virus that is responsible in almost 87 to 94% cases. There is now a thought process if also of those 6 to 20% which may not be HPV associated, but that is a different topic as of now. So let us address the HPV associated cancers. And these infections start occurring in teenagers or whenever the women become sexually active. Having more than one sexual partners makes the person susceptible to have the infections, not using condoms. Smoking is another enhancer of the malignancy. A weakened immune system, as I emphasize, cases of HIV or other immune disorders will also be susceptible to develop the cancer. Daughters of women who took diethylstilbestrol during pregnancy also have a tendency to develop this malignancy. There is a genetic predisposition and there is also a predisposition in races. So the African the races as well as the Asian races are more have a higher tendency as compared to the Caucasian population. I will emphasize here that socioeconomic factor is a definite increased risk for presence of cancer cervix, and approximately there is a 100% increase in risk of the lower social class getting the disease as compared to the higher social class. And maybe, question mark, that is also one of the reasons why this disease is not really high up on the priority list for prevention. So the human papillomavirus per se is, okay. So the carcinoma cervix is, you have the different types of CA cervix, and it can either, the site can be involved is either the ecto or the endo. I will not get into these details, but I will just say here that there are two types of cancers, and then you have a squamous cell carcinoma and you have an adenocarcinoma which can occur, and both have been known to be associated with HPV. So the HPV virus is a DNA virus, unlike the RNA virus, which is corona. And but all these viruses have a tendency to integrate into the DNA of the cell. And during the process of that integration, they tend to activate the cancer-causing genes or cause mutations within them. And the cell thereby undergoes a malignant transformation. There are several molecules which are involved in the pathway. And in terms of CA cervix, there are a couple of molecules like E6, E7. You have a P16 molecule, and these are also used. Why I'm mentioning them is that these are also used in the diagnostic algorithm. So if you want to diagnose more accurately that the malignant cells are present there, a P16 expression or looking for the E6, E7 proteins may also further enhance the accuracy or the specificity of your diagnosis. So what happens basically when cancer cervix develops? You have stages of development of cancer. One is a CIN1, which is a carcinoma in situ, is basically a cervical intraepithelial neoplasia, which is limited. So it's a very limited disease, which is CIN1. Then you have a CIN2, which is a moderate disease. And you have a CIN3, which is a severe. Apologies for the mistaken spelling here. So that's, it's a severe dysplasia of or what we also call as a carcinoma in situ. It's a sitting carcinoma. It still hasn't invaded as yet. Beyond a point, this tumor then invades into the underlying tissue, and that is when it becomes life-threatening. So until the disease is a CIN 1, 2, or 3, and you catch it at that point, this is also a treatable, a very much treatable, easily treatable ailment. And the patient, if caught in this stage, would survive. So the target of the screening is to basically catch the patient as a CIN patient so that subsequently there is no threat to life to this case. So what will you look at? So there are a couple of things that we can do. A few things. One is the visual inspection of the cervix. So this is how the cervix looks like if you look at it with a colposcope. I'll get into that too. So then you can appreciate the presence of the growth, appreciate presence of these acetovite areas or these very reddish areas over the erythematous areas as we call them. And then if you take a scrape from these, you take a scrape of this using a spatula and you make a smear. Those smears will then show you the presence of malignant cells. So here, this is a normal looking cervix, the smear is looking normal, just a transient infection or something. And then here you're obviously seeing that there's a growth or a problem here, acetovite areas are present, and here there's an obvious growth. So subsequently, the cytology of these cases will also show the presence of cancer. So there will initially be a normal cell. This is a stage of progression. You have infection, this progresses to a pre-malignant lesion, and then this progresses to an invasive cancer. Again, I will emphasize the point of the screening, what we call as the secondary screening, because this is a screening that's happening after the disease is developed. So this is called a secondary screening. And the point of the screening here is to catch the cases when there is either a low, an LCIL as we call it, a low grade lesion or a high grade lesion or an HCL which is present in the cervix. So if you look at here, this is a normal epithelium and this is again the normal glandular epithelium. And the tumor usually arises at the transition zone. And this zone then converts into a low-grade lesion, a high-grade lesion, and then it converts into an invasive cancer. So this is the squamous cell carcinoma, and this is a look at the adenocarcinoma where you have a glandular intraepithelial neoplasia which progresses to an invasive adenocarcinoma. So not getting too much into details of this, I would like you to look at this slide which says, which is actually a slide picked up from the American Journal of Clinical Pathology 2012, which was reviewing the US cancer screening program. And as you see here, it says missed opportunities for cervical cancer screening in 8 million women. So the population of the US is 162 million. And missing out those 8 million people who were not screened in the 5 years was like a major thing for them. And they actually went into details as to why they did not get them screened and what, and this whole paper covers the issue per se. And the conclusion they say is that no woman should die because of cervical cancer and we can do better. The question is that can we in India do better? Because what we have right now is a 5% screening of the population of that 165 million that we have it's a half of 135 crores, so less than half. So that's another issue, 48% of the 135 crores. So that's a number we are looking at where we are looking for women in India. So can we do better? What are the modalities that are available to us? So this is what I've just shown you, is that this is the natural history of the disease. You have initially an infection, you have a pre-cancer and a cancer. Let us just remember this much. You have an infection, you have a pre-cancer, you have a cancer. Where do you want to catch this person? Before this point, before the cancer, either pre-cancer or infection. So what are the diagnostic tests which are available to us? The first test that came up was that Pap test. And this Pap test is what I showed you earlier, is a scrape from the cervix. And you do a conventional Pap, or you do, which you look under the microscopy. And there are advanced techniques which are available for Pap now, like the liquid-based cytology, which basically gives you a better morphology. We have it in our lab. And it removes away all the dirt or the hemorrhage and the necrosis from the background. and it also has some automated systems which can review your smear. So as we go further, we'll discuss that there is a problem with manpower for the screening. So if you're looking at those numbers that need to be screened, do we have the pathologists who are capable of screening that many number of pap smears? So the automated systems is another direction in which the ITs have gone forth, the engineers have gone forth and looked for devices which can automatically detect these malignant cells which are present in the smears. For that, the smear quality has to be good, and that's why the liquid-based cytology is used. So you can see here that when we diagnose a normal smear, what is the chance or the risk of malignancy in this patient is it becomes like 0.025%. But when we are doing, that's when we are only doing cytology. And when we are diagnosing a low-grade cancer, the chances of the patient having an invasive cancer is this much. The chances of having a higher-grade lesion is this much. And there is also another thing we diagnose, which is known as an ASCUS, where only occasional cells which are looking doubtful are seen. And if they are looking very malignant, we call it an ASC high. And these are that is called an ASCUS H. And this is the chances of malignancy that are present in these categories. So the nice thing that has happened is that the reporting protocols are very much in place. The instrumentation is there. The issue basically is with the cost, the implementation, the number of healthcare workers, and the communication that needs to be there in order for the screening program to be in place. So the other things that I mentioned to you, like B16, or E6E7, those are the newer technologies which can be applied, but they have still not been put into clinical practice. So you can, to assist you if you are doubtful in the lab, do a P16 stain and see that this highlights. These are actually some of our smears which we had kind of worked on, and we also looked at some higher end techniques like the DNA ploidy. In these cases, we looked for the HPV, presence of the HPV DNA. This was some time back, and then we came up with the sense and spec guidelines. But basically today, when we are talking of cervical cancer, which needs to be done at huge population levels, these are not techniques that can be applied at in large numbers. So the HPV, when we talk about it, has multiple strains. But the ones that are causing cancer are known as the high risk or the HR-HPV. And the most common among them is the 16 and the 18. The others, which are 31, 33, 35, 39, and so forth. So these are the other numbers. And the diagnostics, the one test approach that we've discussed is the cytology. The other thing that we can do is we look for the high risk HPV, which are present in the cervical smears, or the vaginal aspirin. So these HR-HPV, as I told you, they integrate into the viral DNA, and that's how they act and they cause the cell to become malignant. These can be detected, either their DNA can be detected or their RNA can be detected. And various tests have been standardized and approved for diagnosis of presence of high-risk HPVs in females. And this can be used also as a screening test. Because these tests are machine-based tests, and in fact, for the HPV, a self-collection module has also been advocated. So females can actually collect their own smear, because you don't have to specifically scrape the cervix. They can collect their own smear. So this is a very doable thing as far as the population screening is concerned. And this I'm showing you here is some of the tests which are approved by the FDA for testing. You will see here certain terms which are used. One is reflex testing and the other is co-testing. So what we mean by co-testing is that when we are doing both the HPV test and the cytology together. So these tests, if you see the first three, they are actually approved for co-testing. Reflex testing is testing that is done after the patient is detected abnormal. So suppose you have an ASCH And then subsequently, you're following up the patient over time. And 6 months later, you have to do one more test, so more screening tests right there. So that is known as reflex testing. Primary screening of the population is what is the COBUS. So COBUS is the only machine which is actually approved for primary HPV screening. And this is the machine that we have in our lab. The cost of the test is the only limiting factor as far as the HPV screening is concerned. And for this reason, a lot of low-income countries have not been able to use this test for screening. So future direction in this is basically to get hold of tests which are low-cost and easily which can be applied to the population per se, and be of good sensitivity and specificity. So as of now, the COBUS is being used because we are government, we try to subsidize it. So at a very subsidized cost, it is coming to like about 500 rupees per patient. So also, I would like you to take everything, you're all learned people out here, so I'm addressing you in those terms, to take everything with a pinch of salt. So there are always controversies, and though the HRHPV test has been really glorified, and as of now today we call it the more specific test that we have, there are less of biases of observer biases, because this is a machine based test. DNA has to be detected. If it's there, it's there. It's not there, it's not there. There's no subjectivity as far as the interpretation of the results is concerned. However, the studies like the Milan study said that about 4.2% of cases which had a high-grade intraepithelial lesion, a squamous intraepithelial lesion, did not were tested negative in for HPV, and so did Zheng report this these numbers, and that is what in the beginning, if you remember, I mentioned that there is still a set of cancers. Earlier when we were like residents, we were told that 99% or 100% of cervical cancers will show HPV there. And at that point, we were not testing the HPV. We just knew it was caused by that. But as we started testing the HPV, these figures came up. And so we know that there is now a maximum subset of about 15 to 18% cases, which will not be HPV positive. So there are chances of still missing the disease if you are looking at single HPV screening and using that amount of money to screen the patient. So that is the pinch of salt that we need to swallow with this. And as I told you, the co-testing would be the best then, because then you're looking both at the cytology and at the test. The second thing I need you to understand is there is a pyramid out there. So it's not as if all cases who have HRHPV are going to have the disease. It's about a small fraction of them which would finally go on to have the disease. So this virus will infect, and as we know, our body gets infected, it deletes and removes the viruses, heals and moves on. So the body may just heal and move on, or just have the virus and not become malignant. So those are possibilities. So when we do an HPV test, we are not saying that this patient actually has the tumor. We are saying that this patient has the high-risk HPV. So subsequently, you need to go for a so that's some data out there, which shows you that, which is just emphasizing what I just said, that in normal patients, about 12% of them may show HPV testing positive and so forth. So in squamous cell cancer, 95% will be HPV positive, but the percentage positivity gradually increases. So chances of missing HSIL or high grade lesion is almost 11%, and chances of missing a low-grade lesion are almost 24% right here. Do we have any questions in between? I'd be happy to take them.
We'll take the questions later on.
Okay, sure.
Yes.
So, yes. And then we add the P16 expression to the cytology, and we see that again, The normal cases may also show you positive results along with the abnormal cases. So we all know and we understand, and that's what we're trying to understand here, trying to communicate to you here, is that there will be a sense and spec to the testing, and not all cases will be picked up and not all cases will be diagnosed accurately. So the other thing, the other armor that we have in testing for cervical cancer is the visual inspection of the cervix. And this visual inspection of the cervix is done by an equipment which is known as a colposcope. So it's a scope which is introduced into the vagina, and then you can visualize using a camera the look of the cervix. And when you're visualizing, you can use the affinity of the cervix for Lugol's iodine, because it has glycogen in it. And then we presume that the tissues which become cancerous get a lower concentration of glycogen, and so they take up a different color. So we look at this, with this. So this is known as visual inspection of the cervix with Lugol's iodine, shortly known as VILI. So we will be talking about VILI as a method for screening for cancer cervix. So we're looking at the cervix. This patient has a patch which is not picking up or not staining with Lugol's iodine. And this is another patient who's got a larger growth which is not taking up the Lugol's iodine. Then the other painting that you can do is with acetic acid. And then again, the tumor tends to be acetovite. So any tumorous areas tend to become white and they show up. And then additionally, the colposcopics also look at the vascular arrangement or the whenever there's a tumor, vascularity increases. So we look at the branching vessels and all that are present over the tumor lesion. And they suspect that probably this is a region where the tumor occurs. Now in developed setting, if colposcopy was done, the gynecologist would take a biopsy from this site, and then the biopsy would be diagnosed for presence or absence of the malignancy. Alternately, she or he would take a smear from this region and send it for a cytological examination and look for confirmation in the cytology. But suppose you do that, you need a second sitting with the patient. And then when the report from the pathologist or the cytologist comes back is when you will be able to tell the patient that you've got a malignancy. Now, looking at the way we have follow-ups of patients in India, there was this large group from the Lyons Cancer Institute, which was working here. And they recommended, there was Dr. Shastri there in that group from India, originally from India, who had great strengths there while doing the study. There was a lot of controversy, but they recommended that because this, at a single point, you can make out that this is a lesion that is occurring out there, why don't you just treat it at that point? So it's like a one-point contact, you do a colposcopy, and if it's looking like a low-grade or a high-grade lesion, not an overt tumor, you can there and then use a cryo or a LEAP or a loop method to remove that area and then treat the patient there and then. So this was what is known as the VIA or the VILI approach for screening of cervical cancer. So nothing is without controversy. The Pap smears also have a lower sensitivity and specificity. There are chances that the scrape has not been taken from the right area, so you're missing it. Some people just blindly put in the scrape inside and not really scrape the right area, send you the smears. The patient is happy, the test is done, but you're actually not looking at the right side. So this basically, this whole approach that I'm talking about to you right now is the secondary prevention approach of cervical cancer, where now we can see we have an armamentarium of Pap smears, of testing for HPV. And then we have the VIA and we've got the VILI. Okay, so then revising that, we've got these four armamentaria with us as far as secondary prevention of cervical cancer. Why do we call it secondary? Because this is a prevention that's occurring after the disease has already occurred. Okay, so the question now is that can we primarily prevent it? Okay. So which of these secondary prevention methods we want to move on, whether we want to look at the cytology model, whether we want to go with the molecular model, whether we want to go to the hybrid model, which is the HPV and the PAP. Obviously, it seems that this would be the best penetration in the population at 60% of this would like kind of help us a lot. But this is again an expensive approach. So the treatment options, as I mentioned at the VR, the general treatment options are this LEAP or what we or the where basically an electrosurgical cauterization of that area is done, and it can be done as an OPD procedure. A laser sort of an zone, the transition zone is where the tumor occurs. So a laser excision of the transition zone or a loop cone biopsy where the entire transition zone is kind of coned out of the cervix is something that can be done. Ablative methods like cryopoetry, electrodiathermy, coagulation, laser, all these are OPD procedures which can be used at the site where the screening has been done. So that is why Shastri and group thought that this is probably a great method of doing it, and you can at one point see and treat the patient. Then again, as I said, there will always be controversies. And let us look at the US screening program. So if Shastri recommended this for us, the same thing was also recommended for sub-Saharan Africa. My question is that are we sub-Saharan Africa? Are we like that low down on the economy list that we need to adopt a methodology where we cannot invest in the health of our women? And so let us look at what the US screening guidelines are. The US screening guidelines say no screening before 21. And when they do cytology alone from 21 to 29, so they catch them pretty early. And then from 30 to 35, they do a co-test. So that's what we looked at, that's ideal. So they do an HPV and a cytology co-test. If this comes negative, then you do it every 5 years. So it's not as if you have, they repeat it. And what we are talking of in our population as of now is a one-point contact. I mean, we are not even targeting approaching the whole population. And this 5% figure of approaching the population multiple times. And this 5% figure that I'm talking about is the figure of a one-time contact with those percentage of your population. So it's something that we really need to think about. So they have the co-test, after which they ask the patient to come back after 5 years. And if they are doing cytology alone, which is just acceptable, they will ask the patient to come back every 3 years. And if they are doing HPV alone, then also every 3 years, starting at the age of 25. And then after 65 years of age, this screening is discontinued. So if you see the approach, if you have a HRHPV test, it's come out negative. As a routine, you would call the patient back after 3 years. If it is positive, you do a cytology triage. If the cytology is normal, you rescreen at 12 months and then you call the patient back after 3 years. If the cytology is abnormal, so just basically the whole protocol is there and you're repeating the tests over and over again till finally, if you believe that the patient has even a borderline abnormal lesion, you refer for colposcopy, which we showed you was the visualization of the cervix, and then you go on and you do the treatment as and when required. This is the algorithm. So it's not as if nothing was done here. And in the past, the program somehow started picking up in 2006. People like were trying to push it, and then this whole recommendation about doing the VR villi came in. There was a successful implementation in Tamil Nadu, where they implemented the program initially in a couple of districts. They thought it was working well. And then they extended it to a lot of districts. So a lot of Tamil Nadu got covered. So this 5% probably is coming from those states where the coverage was a little higher. And so this, the VR alone, was practiced in terms of the screening. So, but then we all realized that HPV testing and co-testing is what would be ideal. And so the FOGSI, or the Association of Obstetrics and Gynecologists of India, a very active organization, they have come up with recommendations for how to deal with cervical cancer in India. So they have good recommendations. We have an institute in Delhi which is dedicated to basically looking for prevention of cancer, and their main focus initially actually started as a cytology institute for screening of cervical cancer way back in 1976. What actually worries us now is that why have these programs not adequately picked up? Where is the vacuum? Where is the problem? These are areas that need to be addressed. So this is recommendations of FOGSI, which says you can go for VI alone if there is no, please note the critical word here, is no affordability. So if the patient cannot afford, he goes for an inferior thing. If the patient can afford, they can go for the co-testing, which is recommended here. So a summary of the FOGSI recommendations, basically an HPV testing, a co-testing, a cytology, a colposcopy, and a biopsy with a VR in cases in good resource settings. And in limited resource settings where patients cannot afford, is where they are recommending a VIA and a colposcopic biopsy. So the age in the target, please, I would like you to note the differences here. So the age target for the good resource setting is 25 to 65, because the 25 is the HPV testing here. And the age target for the VIA is 30 to 65. And then the age at which to start the testing would be 25 here, the co-testing at 30, and then 30. So 30 to 65 is the window in which you need to test. So the numbers go down, because then that's 30 to 65 is the numbers that you're looking at when you're targeting the women. And then just, this is not for you to actually go through, but just to tell you that when a particular diagnosis comes out, like LCL, HCL or whatever, there is then a proper recommended protocol as to, suppose this comes out in cytology, what do you subsequently have to do? So everything, the protocols are in place, the inverted commas, developed world is using it, but the question mark is why we are not. So this was about the secondary prevention. Coming to the primary prevention, that would be before the disease has occurred, and you would require then there a vaccine. And we do have vaccines for HPV. So the HPV vaccination is actually the most pragmatic cancer prevention therapy. So if we can, for the age group of 30, where the vaccine was not available and they have not been vaccinated, they can be screened through the program and a co-test or a VIA, wherever we are placing our program. And for the younger age group, for the adolescents, it is advised now that they should undergo a vaccination program. So we will come then to a point where our vaccinated individual, the adolescents, will not get an HR-HPV infection and will subsequently not develop the malignancy. We will at 30 start screening, and subsequently, because of the screen, catch the patients early, and our overall mortality would go down. So the incidence of decrease the incidence of the disease, as well as to decrease the mortality, we need to do both. We need to give a primary prevention measure of vaccine, and we need to do a secondary screening of the population as of now. And when our vaccinated population gets to 60 years of age is when probably we can decrease the screening program. So the HPV vaccination is not like a huge vaccination which is done every year. We just need two doses at 6 months apart in girls which are younger than 14 years of age. And in girls who are between 12, more than 14, we give three doses of the vaccine. So this can also generate a herd immunity. And the first country to actually start giving the HPV vaccine as a national program was Australia. And this was in 2006. So they now have data on the decreased incidence of HR-HPV in their population, which has now reached 30, 35 years of age. And the other thing they are also looking at is that there is a development of a herd immunity. as a result of which, see, this is an STD which is transmitted. So if the incidence goes down, the transmission also goes down. So there is a herd immunity, and we are hearing so much about herd immunity now with coronavirus. So with this immunity developing, this would actually decrease the transmission of the virus also as such in the population. And that would be a third prong by which the disease incidence would go down. So primary prevention would involve a risk reduction approach. And this can also, along with the vaccine, what you need is like sex education, education in terms of sexual health, in you need the immunization, you need in the broader sense in prevention, the education, the empowerment, the awareness, and the approach to health services for the population in order for this program to be effective. So the questions arise there is in the vaccine is that this is again an expensive program. And when our government officials talk about it, they say that if we start giving this vaccine free of cost, our entire other vaccination program will kind of go haywire because we don't have the kind of funds to focus on this. So the thing is that can we increase the funds because it's just not important enough. And the other thing is that can we not get this vaccine at a lower cost? So there are certain initiatives like the Gavi, which is the Global Access for Vaccinations Alliance. And then you also have the WHO, which is coming in between. You have the OPS, the PAHO, all these multinational organizations, which are trying to provide us the quadrivalent vaccine at a low cost. So this is what the Gavi publication says, that they are trying to get the cost of the vaccine down to $5. So that would mean that two doses of $5, like a $10 for one adolescent girl to be vaccinated. I think a good investment if you're looking at the tragedy which is happening because of those 60,000 odd deaths that you are getting annually and so many families getting destroyed in just one country. So this is one thing. And then the outstanding vaccine trials, there will always be progress. So can we, instead of targeting the adolescent population, actually give it to the infant, add this to the infant immunization schedule, because that is the point where all vaccines are usually given and the children are more approachable at that point. So maybe the adolescent girls, they don't come back to the vaccine clinic. So can this be given in the infant? The immunization schedule of the infant is one area of research that is going on, and short bridging studies are being done to see whether these small number, relatively small number of children will have effective immunity subsequently. And then also novel HPV vaccines, this is a quadrivalent vaccine, see, so it's targeting four of those HR-HPVs. The other HR-HPVs are not getting targeted, so those rare cancers which are occurring because of those will not get prevented because of this vaccine. So you're looking at vaccines which will actually add more HR-HPV types to the vaccine immunity. So repeating again, the what you have in your array now is the VIA. You have the VIA and the villi, and then you have the digital photography. The other thing that they did was that maybe there may be a problem of interpretation, because what they have done is to train the nurses and the healthcare workers, because you don't have enough doctors to go down and do like every bit of the population. A good initiative, if the training is good, is to see that. And then they can provide like digital access to the images to doctors where the nurses and all are not sure that whether something needs to be done here or not. So digital photography with sharing of images and VIA there. And then you have HPV testing, and then you have HPV vaccination. So this vaccine cost preferably trying to come down, but right now it is where it is at $1.50 for a dose. So just summarizing what we've discussed so far, we have looked at the occurrence of this disease, and we saw that there is a peak that is the peak of the disease is in the red curve, and this is the HPV infection. And the HPV infection occurs anytime, starts occurring after the sexual life of the woman starts, And there is a tendency with more sexual partners, less use of condom, unhygienic practices in which the HPV infection, it kind of flourishes. And some there's a lag phase between the development of the malignancy and between the HPV infection. And then the pre-cancer comes and then the cancer comes up to the age of 65. So please note that if that many people had HPV infection, I hope you can see the arrow. That many people had HPV infection, the cancer that is going to happen is much lower. Then coming to the prevention strategies, you had the VIA and then you had the HPV test. And you had, so if where the VIA is positive, maybe there you could do an HPV test, but no, they haven't added anything beyond VIA. So what we thought was that maybe the VIA can be done, but then at least in a percentage of cases, if you do a cytology or an HPV or a biopsy, at least you're sure that what you're treating is actually getting treated is the disease. So that's a thing that can be added to the VIA. Then you can have the HPV and the co-test, this one, and then you can have the HPV followed by the VIA. So that is, these are the two the approaches that can be done as far as the screening for the cancer is concerned. Looking at the screening programs in Asian countries, there are screening programs as of now in China, India, Indonesia, Japan, and Korea. And all other countries are using the HPV or the cytology testing approach. Only India and Indonesia are using the VIA approach in the Asian continent. And as I said earlier, this is also the prevalent methodology in sub-Saharan Africa. What bothers me basically here is the comparison between China, India, Indonesia, Japan, Korea. We are the ones who are using VIA alone. Indonesia has added cytology to the VIA. And please note the percentage uptake rates. I mean, we are the lowest at 5%. That is question mark acceptable or not. So this is the current situation. These are the tests which are available. This is the treatment that's available. It's something you even have a self-collection modality. You have a great test, which is machine-based, but a little expensive. You have treatments that can be given at an OPD level. So everything's right there in your armor. The point is to use it and to actually have that focus to divert your funds towards the need of those women who are getting infected or affected by the disease. So the paradigm of cervical cancer prevention would be then to introduce the new paradigm, the reframed paradigm should be to introduce a routine introduction of HPV vaccinations, to do an HPV-based screening. And then for those HPV-positive ones, we can go as a subsequent testing for cytology confirmation or VIA confirmation or biopsy confirmation. And then the other interesting point I'm putting up here is that can this vaccination program be extended to boys? So we have now realized that HPV-based cancers are not just cervical cancer, but also the oral cancer, penile cancer, vaginal cancer, vulvar cancer. Okay, these are women cancers, but these are male cancers. The anal cancer, the oral, and the penile cancer. So a lot of programs now have extended the vaccination to adolescent boys also. And this would then prevent the whole cycle of this HPV. And then also please note that when the disease is coming to women, it is a sexually transmitted disease. So it can be coming through males. And so if males are also vaccinated, the cycle of the disease breaks further. Then certain special screening circumstances need to be considered, like pregnant women, how they would be dealt when you are screening, and also women with HIV or other immunocompromised disorders. So the new paradigm should address these issues, I feel. Finally, just covering a little on what are the social and economic consequences of cervical cancer. The magnitude we have discussed, it's huge. There is a woman suffering there in the middle in the center of the family. The whole family is affected. There is a major psychosocial problem there, psychological problem occurring there. The child care is affected. There's inadequate child care. There are school absenteeism. The economic issues, there is patients lose their jobs. The caregiving relatives lose their jobs. There is a dismal reduction in the work-related benefits because they are able to give less hours to work. So the entire family gets affected because of cervical cancer. So when we are talking of those 60,000 people, we should actually multiply it by 5 at an average, or maybe 4 of the family members who would actually be affected by the disorder. When we are applying, the second thing is that scientifically we have seen that what is the screening methodology to be applied. But when applying it, we have to look at the other end. What is the acceptability? What is the adoption? What is the appropriateness of the technique? Are they willing to take it? See, this is an examination where you are looking at an internal examination in a woman. So sometimes there are just a hesitation to just approach and get this done. So this needs to be kind of made like the sanitary napkin using program. You know, you need to kind of make it a more acceptable thing, an acceptable thing to talk about, an acceptable thing to just be there on the radio telling everybody that this is it. I mean, this is the etiology of cancer. This is what you need to get done. This is the protocol for going and getting yourself tested. This is mandatory. These are the problems that can occur. What are the suspecting symptoms? Are you getting a little bit of like bleeding or occasional in between your menstrual periods? Are you having pain? Those kind of things, if they are told the symptoms and where to go, how to go. And more importantly, I think, this disparity between the urban and the rural settings in terms of screening needs to be addressed. And for simple techniques like screening, at least this disparity can be removed. So we have to understand here that there will be a multiple contact. If cervical cytology sample is collected, it will be transported to the laboratory, it will be reported, it will come back. And when we've looked at these, you know, like suppose you have this, these are things that need to be addressed in screening programs. You've got like 30, suppose actually you had 30 out of 1,000 women which had the HSIN. When they came to the pap smear, even if you had a great program, which was actually approaching like 60% of the population, 18 would be coming to you for screening. And then out of which their slides would be read at the lab, maybe in between there were some problems, bad collection, not readable slides, whatever. 13 in a good circumstance would get back a report. Out of which I'm giving it a very high number as far as India is concerned, that 12 actually come back to give their report, get their reports. Sometimes we send back the reports, people are not even like coming back to get them. And for the positive cases, when we go try trace them, the addresses are so vaguely written that they are really hard to find those people. Like if they come out positive, we are really interested that we should somehow communicate to the person so that she goes ahead and gets her treatment in time. So those are major issues, you know, like, of course, with these mobile numbers that have come up, it's become a little easier because people have phones, but then they keep changing their SIMs every 3 months. So this is a problem of follow-up is like huge when it comes to screening. And probably that was one of the reasons why they thought a 1-point VR with the treatment at that point might work in Indian circumstances. But of course, we are compromising with something which is not the end quality. So the barriers need to be removed. The barriers that are there would be like the economic burden, the services in rural areas where no treatment centers are there, the infrastructure deficiencies, the absence of healthcare workers. So those are barriers that are present. And so VI may be recommended via in certain circumstances where the cervical cancer testing and the pap smear tests, either the costs are too high or the patient response is bad, they don't come back. Where a 1-point testing can still be recommended. And even if this program is taken forth, my question is why just 5%? Why is this not addressing more of the population? Whatever its efficacy, at least it should be there. It should be there applicable to a much larger number of people in the population. Then high-end testing and vaccination provisions should be focused through strong government efforts with international agencies. try to kind of decrease it. We did have a vaccination effort through the Gates Foundation, which was done in Andhra Pradesh in two districts. But unfortunately, this was, I think, 2011. But unfortunately, a couple of deaths occurred during that point. And they were these children, two girls who had gone for swimming or something. And they subsequently, probably they said later that it was a pneumonitis that developed. But at that point, the trial was immediately stopped. And because of the controversies that came through a lot of, opinions, the trial was stopped entirely. And then the government plan of the vaccine somehow was put on a shelf at that point and never got off the shelf. But now we know a lot of countries are using it. And it's about time that a government-based vaccination program of discounted or free provisions, as well as discounted and free screening, should be there for the population at large. The cost effectiveness could be increased by creating models in clinics. And as I will show you here, you can have vaccination before 12 years of age for the HPV 16 and 18. This bivalent vaccine has gone down further in cost. So either a bivalent or a quadrivalent vaccine, which is affordable. Then screening of all women up to 30 years of after 30 years of age with at least a 70% coverage. And then HPV test, DNA testing, at least twice in a lifetime. We are looking there at every 5 years of testing, but at least twice in a lifetime, maybe at say 35 to 40 years of age, and then again at another a decade later, to say that the HPV negative ones are then out of the arena with those 15% problem of HPV negative cancers are out for further screenings down the line. When we look at that, so if we can look at those low-cost vaccines and low-cost HPV DNA, then maybe we can approach this screening in a better way as compared to the VR. The other principal barriers that are there are the healthcare workers, which need to be trained, and the lack of follow-up, as we have discussed, and the lack of supplies or infrastructure, as we have also discussed. So the paramedical staff can be used, self-collections can be encouraged, and local larger training networks can be set up. So this is this is Dr. Rajan Devar from the University of Ann Arbor, and he was with us, and we were actually working on this massive online open course, a MOOC program for PAPS. And we built these electronic, he built actually the electronic training modules in which I just taught a few of the lectures there. And these were small, short lectures, 6 minutes, different modules for how to do different things in the Pap smear evaluation, so that the healthcare workers were given both hands-on training as well as they were exposed to these MOOC programs, so that we could have a large resource which could do the screening of the cervical smears. So mobile units can come up and actually approach the people there. The community engaged approach will be required, where leaders within the community, the healthcare workers which are involved with the community, can be involved for the screening. And hospital-based screening should also be parallel recommended. So women, sometime or the other in their life, they visit a hospital. So the point is that even if we have a hospital-based screening and any woman that's coming over there gets screened, regardless of whatever complaint she's coming for, is where we can actually catch them. So that's another area where screening can be done. So I will conclude then with my key messages. That is, the high-income countries have shown a sharp decline in the past 40 years. So rates in the US were the same as what we have as of now in the 60s. And they have now gone down to 2 or 3 per 100,000 population. And yet they are looking at that huge screening program. They are still continuing it. And they are giving HPV vaccines. And us with a rate of 15, an underreported rate of 15 per 100,000 population, we are not looking at implementing a huge program. We are trying, but we are not effectively implementing a huge program for that. And then I would like to emphasize again that cancer cervix is highly preventable. HPV vaccination for all girls could avert these 690,000 cases with 420,000 deaths worldwide. 409,000 deaths worldwide over our lifetime. And the cytology-based screening programs are unsuitable for lower-income countries, but co-testing is ideal. But HPV testing, hospital-based co-testing is ideal, but VIA can be used, but maybe an HPV-based test along with VIA would also make it more effective. HPV is a great promise, but it's expensive. So we need to get the cost down. Simultaneously, behavior change, communication exercises will have to go on. Specific health education sessions involving both men and women to facilitate the care seeking. And the should we vaccinate only the girls or the boys is another take that we need to decide on. And the research needs to be carried out to make the HPV tests cheaper. I know that people are on it. And we had been asked at some point to collect samples for those people who were testing a cheap HPV test, but we still have to hear back from them. At the bottom line, I would like to say that what we require is honest, efficient, genuine, committed implementation in order for this screening program to work. So I strongly believe that investing in the health of girls and women is an investment in the development of the nation and their futures. And let us explore ways also to divide, to lessen this divide between the lower and the middle income group countries and the high income group countries in terms of screening for breast and cervical cancers. Thank you for your patience, Terry.
Thank you for such an in-depth presentation in such a simple language, Nozhatji. And I can only say amen to what you have wished for. And I wish it's not... only the divide is reduced between high and low income countries, but also within the country between high and low income groups and between men and women. Because as you said that HPV is a virus which is sexually transmitted. So it is going from men to women and and that is why vaccinating both of them is very important.
And additionally, there are certain cancers in men which are also HPV associated. So it would be like a direct benefit to men also. Right. Because we also now we know that the cancer of the penis, the anal region, as well as the oral cavity, they are also associated with human papillomavirus. So the general cancer low would be there if we vaccinate everybody.
We now open for question and answer session. Participants, please type in your questions in the chat box or raise your virtual hand if you wish to speak. We already have a few questions that have come up. Nivedita Arjun, would you like to ask your question, please?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Hello, ma'am. So if cervical cancer is detected at the time of pregnancy, then what would its effect be on the fetus? I saw somewhere that the cancer itself may not have an effect on the baby, but its treatment could have an effect. And I'm not sure about the validity of this statement, but if it is true, then what would you suggest, ma'am, that women in this situation should do?
Yeah, so you are absolutely right that the cancer as such is not going to grow into the baby. So it usually doesn't affect the development of the baby. And what is tried to be done is to... we avoid chemotherapy or any types of toxic drugs which are given for the therapy. But if a limited surgical excision is required, then in care that can be done, and it can be done. Or some then it's otherwise it's a wait and watch situation where then you wait for the baby to come to term and you operate or you do a cesarean section to take out the baby and you address the malignancy at the same time.
We have a question from Saida Deep, who wants to know that, of course, she thanks you for your excellent presentation. And she wants to know if it is possible to get one test that can screen for more than one cancer. And also, please help us understand why cervical cancer rates per lakh population are high in countries like Nepal. And this question has come from somewhere else also.
So, Saida, thanks for your attention. As far as the single test testing, it's really not there because the cancer is not one disease, it's different diseases. So wherever it occurs, it has a different methodology of occurring, a different severity, and a different etiology. So here it is HPV based, so we are doing an HPV screening. But if you say single test, it's like if you say cytology, but then that you have to do it at different sites. So wherever the cancer is there, you have to do it at that site. And then you have serum biomarkers, which are used for diagnosis of some cancers, but those biomarkers are also specific to the type of cancer. So we really don't have a single test as far as that question is concerned. Your other question was regarding the Nepal high incidence. So we see that, as I said, this is associated with a lower socioeconomic status. And I understand that the Nepal population is not really well. Then we are also well socioeconomically. The other, I really didn't want to bring this up, but the other thing, and most people who talk about prevention say you should not emphasize this because then it makes a particular sect feel that they are immune to the disease. But the circumcision practice in males actually decreases the presence of HPV in males. And subsequently, Muslim women, if you look at incidence in communities, they have less cervical cancer as compared to others. So this is a heterogeneous country, and we are looking at incidences which are averaged out. And if you go back, those charts which I was showing you and all the Middle Eastern countries are showing a very low incidence of cervical cancer. But, so that may be one of the reasons where basically sexual hygiene is an issue.
Okay. Thank you for that answer. What are the symptoms of
cervical cancer? I would like to emphasize again that this statement does not make Muslim women immune to having the disease. We have a lot of cases which occur in Muslim women, and therefore I usually don't like to make this statement in my lectures because nobody should feel that they are immune from getting this disease.
Rightly so. What are the symptoms of cervical cancer? And is it and are women presenting late?
So the women present late for the reason that most cancers are usually, most cancers in most sites of the body, actually they don't involve pain. And pain is one of the reasons why patients frequently come to the doctor. So they become painful only when they start involving the nerves in the region, and then they spread enough. Mm-hmm. So the earliest symptom that you will get in a cervical cancer would be, you will get contact bleeding. You know, like after contact, there would be spotting, and there would also be intervening spotting in between the proper menstrual periods. And there might be foul smelling discharge from the vagina. So those are symptoms that one should be careful about and report to the doctor immediately if you get them.
Okay. I once again ask the participants, if you have any questions, please put them in the chat box or raise your virtual hand. We have already overshot the time, so we'll take in just few more questions. Although I'm sure the presentation has been so lucid and clear that it is bringing so many questions to our mind, Nosadji. You mentioned the data says that only 5% are screened in India, and that too only one time. Is it a reflection on how we treat our women?
It's one of the reasons would be that, yes. One of the reasons would be that, but I wouldn't say that the male cancers are very well addressed either. Mm-hmm. So it's generally like the system, I feel, is so overloaded with treating that screening and prevention has not been given adequate emphasis and budgeting.
Okay.
So that is one area where I think we need to be. There are in every medical college departments of community medicine and prevention. Preventive oncology is but however not a branch which has really been given focused faculty. So at Tata Memorial, they actually have a department of preventive oncology, And there they have been doing this huge work. So some of the data is actually coming from those centers which are adopted by Tata in Maharashtra, where they have come up with these results of the VIA and the VILAI testing that has been done. So even this 5% is actually a reflection of good coverage in some districts and nothing at all in others.
Okay. Again, a reflection on somewhere we value the women more than the other, but that's my personal reflection. So
I think also a reflection on the fact that we don't really give much of our GDP to health. It's just 1-2% of the GDP goes to health.
That's very true.
Obviously, the whole emphasis on health per se in the country is low.
That is very true. You're very right there. Saida Deep wants to ask, Madam, are survivors of cervical cancer involved in campaigning on recommendations which you have made? Because we have other support groups and support groups for breast cancer and all. And even cervical cancer is less talked about. There's a lot of talk about lung cancer. In women, it's mostly concentrated in around breast cancer.
Breast cancer, yeah, true. So there are two problems basically here, which I feel are kind of... One is they attach stigma. You know, it's the surveys, the uterine surveys that you're talking about. I mean, talking about the breast was taboo enough. Then you start talking about the uterine cervix in public. It's like something that would not be acceptable in our culture. So it's about time, as I said, for sanitary napkins, that people should accept that this is it. I mean, this is a woman. She's going to have a breast. She's going to have a uterus. She's going to have a vagina. Like, come on, she can talk about it. So that is one of the issues that is there. Now, the other is that because when... that's another thing that... This was a lecture I talked about it, but when they tell us to actually talk to the public on the screening programs, they tell us not to emphasize too much on the STD nature of the disease. So because then there is another stigma attached to it, you know. So it's like a sexually transmitted disease. So like, you know, there's a stigma to it. And people don't come up. They don't come up to say that I've got this problem. So that's why I think the emphasis should be of the cancer as a cancer to be detected in this methodology rather than how it's occurring. And the second is for women to have confidence to come up and say that this is it. But yes, it's a great idea. I think the women's cancer group should include both the malignancies.
Okay, we have a question from Isha Garg. Perhaps a similar one, but Isha, would you like to ask your question? Isha?
Yes, ma'am, I had the similar question about the reasons for less awareness about cervical cancer, even amongst the women.
Actually, I'm actually surprised that the awareness is low, because probably I think the breast cancer program caught up more and there was a lot of talk about the breast cancer, but cervical cancer has been on the card since the 60s. And the US and other countries have really like kind of, it's a very routine thing there ki pap smear karana hai annually. Earlier the recommendation was annual pap smears. So it was like a done thing that annually whenever you go for your health checkup, your part of the health checkup was getting a pap smear done for a woman. And now they make it every 3 years. So that's like a thing that was like a done thing. But somehow in our country, because it's not a done thing, it somehow hasn't really picked up so much. But yes, it's very much there, and it was until 5 years back the most common cancer that we had in women.
And maybe another reason is in many countries now, HPV vaccination for HPV is in the national programs, not only in Australia, but
now it's there in 62 countries.
Yes, it's in so many countries, and perhaps that also reduces the stigma, that so-called stigma around the disease. Because then women and the girls come to know about it at an early age, and they know why they are taking that vaccination. So
vaccine is a way to go.
Yes.
That's really a way to go.
Yes. And I really hope that...
It's available in private in our country. Yes. And a lot of adolescent girls in the higher economic strata are getting it. Mm-hmm. But this needs to go through the government program, because otherwise it will not be taken.
Yes. So before we close, because we have overshot the time, just one take-home message from Nozadji, for women as well as for men.
Well, I need a promise from all of you that you'll inform at least 100 people about this to go and get the pap test done. or at least get an HPV testing done and try to spread awareness and let us try to decrease this gap that is there in the population.
Okay, thank you. Very, very good message you have given. So with this, we come to the end of today's discussion. In this session of SDG Talks, co-hosted by Indian Institute of Management Indore and CNS, we were listening to Dr. Nusrat Hussain on cervical cancer screening and the importance of it. Bye for now, till we meet again next week.
Thank you, bye. Stay safe. And
Stay safe. And our sincere thanks once again to Nusrat Ji for this very insightful talk. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.